I want to really say that we're both extremely honored to be here. And it's humbling a bit to receive this prize in Marjory Stephenson's name. She was the second president of SGM, wrong continent. And the other reason why we're quite honored by it is her work, as you may know from her, if you know her, a little bit of read about her biography, which is written up in a 1948 biochemistry journal article. In her obituary, she worked on anaerobic metabolism in bacteria. But I think also in reading her a little bit about her work, what was important was that she was not just looking at anaerobic metabolism in bacteria. She was trying to understand more fully metabolism using that as a model system. So today what we would like to do is we hope convince you that viruses are very useful as model systems for looking at cancer so that we can understand not only viral cancers but also cancers that are not caused by viruses. Now this is a slide. There are three things I'd like to tell you about this slide. First of all, it shows the seven viruses that are known to cause cancer, and I'm certain all of you are aware of these seven viruses. Most important thing that is not widely recognized is that infection causes 20% of human cancer cases worldwide. That is a huge number, and it's not really widely appreciated, certainly not in the oncology community. But those cancers, of course, could be targeted with antivirals or antibacterials or antiparasitics and by vaccines that would be relatively toxic and would, of course, be able to target these cancers that are caused by infectious agents. Now, the second thing that if we look at this list, it's a bit perplexing, right? Because we see that Epstein-Barr virus is a double-stranded DNA virus right here. Then the next one down is a single-stranded DNA virus that thinks it's a retrovirus. And then there's a bona fide retrovirus, RNA virus, a positively stranded RNA virus, a small DNA tumor virus, and large DNA tumor virus, and so forth. So what's the pattern? What's the connection? Why do this? What is similar among these viruses? And that's really been what's perplexed tumor virologists over the last century, really, since the original Bang and Ellerman and Rouse experiments, is what are the common features of a virus that would make it cause cancer. Now, the other thing that's important about this list is what's not on the list is that these are only seven of the thousands or tens of thousands of viruses that infect us and that persist in us. And almost each one of these viruses has a near neighbor, has a close relative that doesn't cause cancer. So why is that? Well, I can't even pretend to tell you that I'm going to give you the answer, but I'm going to hopefully say some common features about tumor viruses. And I'll start off here. There are four things that I'd like to talk about. And the first is that a common feature among viruses that cause cancer is that they're persistent, they're chronic infections, but they're non-permissive. The viruses do not replicate on their own within cells to form virions to be transmitted. And that's actually quite important because now many people, of course, are using viruses as oncolytic therapies for cancer to try and target cancers, to get rid of cancers. Completely the opposite effect to what we're asking here. And that's why does a virus cause cancer? And you can imagine the reason why this would be is soon as a virus initiates lytic replication and starts multiplying itself within a cell, then a number of innate immune signaling pathways are turned on, telling that cell that it must die to prevent propagation of the virus. And so that virus replication, not always, but generally, is fatal to the infected cell. And so the second corollary to that is if we're going to find viruses, then using physical methods to find viruses that cause cancer is not terribly helpful. Instead, it's a matter of gene hunting, just like looking for oncogenes that are non-viral related. Now, if viruses that cause cancer are non-transmissible, then the other thing that sorts out from it is that viral tumors are biological accidents, and that's true. Most of us in this room, almost all of us, are infected with EBV, and very few of you probably have a current Burkitt's lymphoma right now, or a nasopharyngeal carcinoma. And I've showed this slide to illustrate this case. This is a wildebeest. It's infected with a herpes virus known as the alkalophene herpes virus, and it's perfectly asymptomatic in its native host. But this virus is very well known because wildebeest can transmit this to domesticated cows and cause bovine leukemia. Similarly, which all of you know, is a polyomavirus. Its major oncoprotein is the T antigen oncoprotein that Yuan will talk a little bit in the second half of the lecture for MCV. And this virus does not cause cancer in its native host, the rhesus monkey, nor does it cause cancer in humans, at least as far as I can tell. But it does cause cancers when you inject it into Syrian hamsters. Each one of these are dead-end events. So they are not central to the biology of the virus. These are rare accidents that occur during viral infection. Now, the third point that I'd like to raise, and it's important when we talk about causality, does this virus cause this cancer, is the idea that cancer viruses, like any other virus, have a series of risk factors, and that host contributions are incredibly important, environmental contributions are incredibly important as to whether or not the virus will cause cancer. And this is illustrated by this picture of the Sabah Peninsula in Malaysia, which has a high rate of EBV-associated nasopharyngeal carcinoma. We don't really know the reason why that is, but one speculation is the people along that coast eat dried fish that contains a high level of nitrosamines and that act as alkylating agents, and so it makes a very pleasing hypothesis that by eating these nitrosamines, they're causing secondary mutations that are contributing together with EBV infection to the genesis of NPC. And we see NPC in other populations around the world that are in fishing communities as well. But there will be many factors that will determine whether or not a virus can cause cancer. Now, the fourth and final aspect that I'd like to talk about is that cancers that are caused by infection are under immune surveillance. That's not perhaps surprising, but what that means is that we can use this feature to figure out which cancers we should look at to see if there is a new virus that's causing those cancers. Now, this is a slide from Andrew Grulich's Lancet paper in 2007. This is the ratio of the rates of various cancers that occur in healthy populations versus AIDS populations or transplant populations. So if the little bar here were over one, then that would mean that AIDS patients get these cancers at exactly the same rate as healthy populations. What you can see is in this list of cancers here is that we have extremely high rates of occurrence of these cancers among AIDS and transplant patients. Now, this was used 20, 25 years ago in a brilliant paper that I really urge all the students in the room, all the postdocs, hell, I really want everybody to read this paper. It's a great paper published in The Lancet by Val Barrell and Harold Jaffe, who are two epidemiologists. And what they did was they asked the following question. They said, well, we've got this cancer that's occurring in AIDS patients called Kaposi sarcoma. And it's behaving very strangely. And most of the current scientific thought when they started this was that HIV and HIV TAT itself was driving the proliferation of Kapschi sarcoma. So what they did was they looked at the patterns, and what they found by just looking at the epidemiology was they almost precisely described what we now know is the epidemiology of KSHV, and that is that the KS agent, whatever it would be, should be rare in the general US population. It should be sexually transmitted, but it should be poorly transmitted through blood transfusions, and that it would have a high occurrence in Africa, Mediterranean countries, and less so in North America and in Northern Europe. And those are precisely what was found. So the key point here, if nothing else, is that epidemiology is your friend. Even if you're a very, very basic scientist, it can tell you, point you in important directions if you're studying human viruses and human pathogens. So we use this information in a subtractive PCR technique called representational difference analysis to isolate two small pieces of DNA that turned out to be less than 1% of the virus's total genome. And at the time, it was a bit odd to us in that there were some people who complained, well, you've just isolated a snippet of DNA. You haven't actually isolated the virus. So I want to illustrate, once you do find just 20 base pairs of unique sequence, well, in this case, it was more than 20 base pairs, but theoretically, just 20 base pairs of unique sequence belonging to a new pathogen, then Katie, bar the door, look what you can do. It was published in December of 1994, within a very short period of time. After that, we were able to extend this to all forms of Kapschi sarcoma and to an unusual type of lymphoma called primary effusion lymphoma. And from that, we were able to grow, because the primary effusion lymphoma cells would grow in culture and maintain the virus, we were able to grow the virus in the laboratory and then develop serologic tests to detect infection, to define the natural history of this virus. And just 2 years later, which nowadays, this is ridiculously long, but 2 years later, we were able to sequence this 145 kilobase sequence and identify this as a virus. And by that time, within 2 years, pretty much most of the reasonable arguments had been answered as to whether this virus does cause Kapschi sarcoma or not. Now, this is a remarkable virus. As you can see in this list of genes that it has, I won't go through this in any detail, but it has a cyclin, it has BCL2, it has a FLICE interacting protein, a FLIP. It has, in fact, the FLIPs were discovered first as components of KSHV and a related, closely related virus. Has its own IL-6, it has chemokines and so forth. So it has all of these genes that it's pirated from the human genome and put into its own genome. And that's very interesting, but in terms of trying to find some unifying theme about how does this virus cause Kapschi sarcoma, how does it cause cancer, it raises a problem because none of these genes look like any of the other genes in the six other viruses that I showed in the first slide. What's going on? So instead, if you take a look at the pathways that are targeted by these genes, such as RB, P53, interferon signaling, MHC, and so forth, what we can see is that, in fact, the pathway targeting is conserved with EBV. It's just that the actual gene sequences are not. So there's functional conservation among these two viruses, and you can even extend that in larger or smaller degree to the other tumor viruses. Now, that raises a question, why do viruses have oncogenes? I've already said that these viruses, when they cause cancers, it's a biological accident. There's no evolutionary benefit to the virus, certainly not to the host, but to the virus either in terms of causing a cancer. Well, the standard way of looking at this is based on the small DNA tumor viruses, for instance, HPV, in that it infects a keratinocyte that is in a G0 state, and it drives the cell into replicating state so that it can now harvest the molecular metabolites that it needs in order to replicate its own DNA, initiates lytic replication, and then spreads on. And so in this case, viral oncogenes are central to viral replication, and that a mistake happens, for instance, a mutation or an integration, something else that balls up the works, and that's the reason why tumors arise. But the problem with that is that if we look at the large DNA tumor viruses, this is the major oncogene locus, one of them, in KSHV, and I don't want you to go through and try and figure out what each one of these lanes are, but essentially what we're doing here is we're either inducing or we're inhibiting the replication of the virus with these different chemical treatments, and if we do a northern blot for these genes, all of these genes are perfectly flat. They're latent. They're expressed the same whether the virus is latent or whether the virus is replicating. So these oncogenes are being expressed at the wrong time to promote viral replication. And this leads to a second possibility from the large DNA tumor viruses, particularly from KSHV, that possibly what is happening is that cells sense a viral infection and actually activate tumor suppressor signaling as an innate immune defense mechanism to arrest the cell, to prevent further virus replication, and failing that, to push the cell into an apoptotic state. And for that virus to successfully replicate and be transmitted to another host, it has to target these pathways in order to reinitiate cellular replication. I'm going to skip over this just to make sure I have time for the interesting stuff that Yuan will be talking to you about. But this is a list. I just want to emphasize the importance of innate immune evasion for KSHV. And it turns out that almost all of viruses, to some degree, do this. It's just that KSHV was very obvious in the genes that it pirated and what it was taking. And it sort of led the way into saying that innate immune evasion is incredibly important to these viruses. And so you can see, for instance, K1, complement binding protein, and this is work that has been spearheaded by David Blackburn here in this group, as well as working on the VIRFs. Some of this was done in our lab and in Jay Jung's lab elsewhere, is that there's a lot of the non-structural proteins encoded by this virus that are devoted to knocking out different parts of the innate immune system. But interestingly enough, you didn't know that they were innate immune evasion genes, and you started putting them in rodent fibroblast assays or putting them into monkeys, make transgenic animals, you would see that they're also oncogenic. And so that's leaving us with the idea that, again, tumor suppressor pathways have dual properties. This is illustrated by some work I'm taking from Taniguchi's paper from 2003. I think this is a beautiful and simple piece of data. What this is showing two sets of mice, knockout mice in black and littermates in white, and they've been infected with VSV at a certain dose, and you can see that all of the littermates that are wild type, 80% of them live, whereas the knockout mice die. So what gene is knocked out? Clearly some immune-related gene. Is it the interferon receptor? What is it? It's P53. Again, showing the importance of something that we think is only key as a guardian of the genome or to prevent cancer in preventing viral replication as well. And so from KSHV, I think that we've learned that immunosuppression and innate immunosuppression and tumor promotion are two flip sides of the same coin, in that these viruses are targeting the same pathways that can either prevent viral replication and, under some rare circumstances, accidentally flip a cell into a transformed phenotype and we'll get ongoing replication. So I'll end here just with repeating these four commonalities of replication and competence, host-environmental risk factors that play a role together with virus infection, and biological accidents that tumor viruses that cause tumors are biological accidents. And finally, the concept that innate immune evasion is a key role, plays a key role in preventing contributing to tumorigenesis.
I too would like to reiterate our thanks for the Society for this honor, and I'm particularly gratified by the fact that this lectureship is given and named in honor of a woman scientist. Now, what I'll be doing for the rest of the lecture is to illustrate some of the points that Pat discussed in terms of this new Merkel cell polyomavirus that we found. Now, as with KS epidemiology, which was elaborated so elegantly by Valerie Beryl and Harold Jaffe, so too with MCV, in that Eric Engels, with co-authors, published a paper in The Lancet in 2000 that highlighted the increased rate of Merkel cell carcinoma in HIV-infected individuals. And we were particularly interested in this because we are in the market to find a new tumor virus. And so this being a good candidate, we looked a little bit more in depth on it. And what we know about Merkel cell carcinoma is that it originates from mechanoreceptor Merkel cells that are found in the basal layer of the skin. In addition to being having increased incidence in AIDS populations, the risk factor for development of Merkel cell seems to be immunosuppression. So other immune-suppressed populations, including patients who have had transplant or who are treated for prolonged periods of time, so for example for rheumatoid arthritis, they also are at a higher risk for developing Merkel cell carcinoma. And this tumor is incredibly aggressive. Although uncommon, its incidence has risen threefold in the last 15 years, and 50% of patients with advanced cases of this have less than 9 months survival. Well, we took this carcinoma. We found several cases of it. And we applied a technique that we developed in our lab called digital transcriptome subtraction. And it's actually very similar to RDA, which we used to find KSHV. In that case, we did a physical subtraction. In this case, this is an in silico subtraction, where based on the assumption that a virus acting as a direct carcinogen in cancer tissue would express transcripts or a protein in each and every cell that it infects, we applied this deep sequencing technique to it. And so we parasequenced four cases of Merkel cell carcinoma. And this was work that was done by a postdoc in our lab, Hui Chen Feng, and another postdoc, Masa Shuda. And we sequenced about 400,000 transcripts, churned it through these computer scripts that cleaned up the data set and came out and subtracted out anything that was identified as of being human origin, and came out with about 2,000 candidates that then we blasted against viral data sets. And we found two sequences that identified a new polyomavirus, which was Merkel cell polyomavirus. And soon after the identification, it was, you know, really easy to churn through this. With, as Pat mentioned, with just a few, a short fragment of sequence, you're able to pull out the remaining genome of a virus. And in this case, Merkel cell polyomavirus was very typical for other polyomaviruses, with a 5.4 kb genome, small double-stranded, very closely related to SV40. In the first couple of years, again, very easy, the first thing that you look at is there a causal association? And our group, as well as other groups, have found that over 80% of Merkel cell tumors are positive for the virus. The virus in these tumors are clonally integrated. They are random in terms of the host genome, but they are viral clonal for the virus. The T antigens that are the business end of tumorigenesis and polyomaviruses are expressed in Merkel cell tumors. An antibody was developed, and here you can see a metastasis of Merkel cell carcinoma to a lymph node where the tumor cells are really brightly outlined with expression, high expression of the T antigen in the nuclei of tumor cells, whereas B cells in the lymph node are not expressing the T antigen. And knockdown studies show that the T antigen locus is required for the survival of Merkel cell carcinoma cells. Another interesting thing, which is actually a variation from what we see with KS, is that Merkel cell carcinoma is actually a ubiquitous infection, and you can PCR it up from multiple sites, and almost everyone in this room is infected with it. And so the question is, how does a common asymptomatic infection cause a rare cancer? So this is very different from KS. When a person is infected with KS, once they become immunosuppressed, boom, you know, there's expression of cancer. This is not so with MCV. Well, we looked at the T antigen of MCV, and it contained, by sequence analysis, all the domains that we see in polyomaviruses. There's a RB binding domain, LXCXE, DNA J domain, an origin binding domain, and a helicase domain. But as we looked at these viral T antigens that came from tumors, that were isolated from tumors, all of them contain missense mutations, all right, that truncated the T antigen, such that what we got in expressed as a protein was the stump of a T antigen protein, which is not what you would want if that is the viral oncoprotein that you're interested in. But take a look at how the functional domains are segregated. The N-terminal portion of the protein contains tumor suppressor targeting domains, whereas the C-terminal region have viral replication functions. And all of the T antigen mutations, what we call signature mutations, follow or are C-terminal to the RB binding domain. So what's the consequence of this? In this replication assay, MCV-derived cell line, in which the viral genome is clonally integrated, is transfected either with wild-type full-length T antigen or truncated tumor T antigens. And a southern blot is done, and we assay for viral DNA. And you can see that there is no endogenous replication, and we don't see replication with the tumor T antigen. But when exogenous full-length T antigen is transfected into these cells, we get robust replication. Well, what does this mean? So, common infection, the virus is circular, it's not integrated, it replicates via its large T antigen. But once it replicates, if the T antigen is intact, the protein will bind to the origin and start replicating, all right? And what the consequence of this would be is that you would get a onion skinning, you would get recruitment of DNA repair response, you would probably get cell death. And so in order for that tumor cell to survive, mutations have to occur in the T antigen that retain the proliferative functions of the protein, but yet truncate or ablate the replicative functions. So MCV, the genome, is replication defective in MCC, in these tumors. And that's actually a reiteration of what Pat touched upon, in that when a virus is associated with a cancer, it is not replication competent. So how does MCV transform healthy cells into cancer cells? I mean, what exactly is that mechanism? That was what we were looking at when we first started sequencing the tumor T antigens. Well, In SV40, we know that the large T is responsible for transformation, that the small T is not, and that it can act to enhance the transforming abilities of large T. And that is actually based on its interaction with PP2A. Well, it's completely different in MCV. And so NASA, along with another postdoc in our lab named Hinjin, they looked at this issue. When lentiviral small T is overexpressed in RAT1 cells, we see the generation of dense foci, which is not seen with large T or with an MT vector. And this is also replicated in soft agar assays, where you see robust colony formation with small T, but not with large T. It's NASA and Jin. They made mutations in the small T that ablated its ability to interact with PP2A. And even with that mutation, we can still see that the tumor form the transformation functions of small T is not affected. Well, despite the finding that MCV small T induced transformation is PP2A independent, the evidence that we have from our lab suggests that the small T transform cells by targeting AKT mTOR cap related cap dependent translations through a molecule called 4-EBP. This is at the distal end of the mTOR kinase signaling pathway. And as shown here in this Western blot here, where we assayed for total 4-EBP and phosphorylated 4-EBP, you can see that rapamycin, an mTOR inhibitor, will quickly reduce the phosphorylation at serine 65 or 4-EBP. When we express small T acts to maintain hyperphosphorylated 4-EBP. And this function of small T is not affected even with rapamycin treatment. And this effect can be seen with TORN1 as well as PP242, active site inhibitors of mTOR. So it appears that the function indeed is distal to mTOR, and that MCV small T targets 4-EBP. And to illustrate this, what we did was to obtain a constitutively active 4-EBP. So phosphorylated 4-EBP will increase cap-dependent translation. When we put small T in, this top panel shows the colony formation in soft agar of small T. When we overexpress 4-EBP, we get a diminution in both the size and the number of colonies that are seen. And when we put in this constitutively active 4-EBP, what we see is that it can reverse the effect of small T, thus strongly suggesting that that 4-EBP is targeted by small T. So this is a variation in terms of what is seen with other tumor viruses that affect the AKT mTOR pathway. And what we have here then is a very good mechanism to look in this really poorly understood process of regulation of proliferation through translational mechanisms. Now, one of the leading clinicians in MCV patient care published this article in 2007. And actually, Pat and I feel that this is perhaps one of the most depressing titles that we've ever come across. Merkel cell carcinoma, more deaths, but still no pathway to blame. And I said before, 50% of patients with advanced MCC die within 9 months of treatment. And so taking what we know in terms of the molecular biology of MCC and the molecular defect, in this case, the introduction of the virus and the viral oncoproteins, could we find or pursue targeted treatment of this very, very aggressive tumor? And so Rita Aurora, a graduate student in our lab, set out to do this exact thing. She said, I want to cure MCC. And she worked with Anna Guastafiero, another graduate student in our lab, as well as Trina Topton, a postdoc in our lab. And they underwent drug library screening, and they showed that MCC was highly chemo-resistant, which is what is seen in patient care. They screened over 1,350 drugs from the LOPAC library and the NCI Oncology Drug Library, as well as ATPase inhibitors that are active with other polyomaviruses. And none of these compounds, except for bortezomib 1, was active at nanomolar levels. But bortezomib was not specific for MCV-positive MCC. So another approach that Reedy took was this idea of rational drug screening for MCV-positive MCC. And what we did was we went back to our DTS analysis, which is really not only good for finding a virus, but it also gives you a quantitative transcriptome profiling of tissues. And Hui-Chen Feng went back and analyzed transcripts that are upregulated and found that survivin transcripts are sevenfold more upregulated in MCV-positive MCCs than MCV-negative MCCs. And so the question is, can survivin be a druggable target? And to answer this question, Reedy found a YM155. This is an imidazole compound. And it was discovered by its effects on inhibiting the survivin promoter. It shows some modest effect in phase 2 trials of non-small cell lung carcinoma, diffuse B-cell carcinoma, and prostate cancers. And what's good about this is that in these clinical trials, this compound has very low toxicity and very few side effects. In our hands, when we test this compound with MCC-derived cell lines, we see that YM155 is cytotoxic at nanomolar levels, and it is actually quite specific, being 2 log more active in MCV-positive than MCV-negative MCCs. So then Reedy developed a xenograft model where cell lines that are MCV-positive are injected into mice. They develop tumors, as can be seen here, at the site of injection that replicate the histologic as well as the immunophenotypic characteristics of MCC in humans. This is expression and detection of the large T in these tumors in mice. And in a 3-week trial of treatment, she used saline, YM155, as well as bortezomib here in these lines. And in these 3 weeks of treatment, 66.7 of the bortezomib-treated and 74.2 of the saline-treated mice had to be, well, they basically reached the euthanasia endpoint. Whereas during this 3-week period, none of the mice treated with YM155 had to be euthanized. In fact, some of the mice, or the tumors in the mice, regressed. However, after YM155 was stopped after this study, these tumors resumed their growth, and these mice developed large tumors and died. So what we know about YM155, at least with this initial study, is actually very optimistic in that although it appears that YM155 is static, it may not be, get rid of the tumor. However, this slide shows that we've actually come a long ways, and really finding a molecular target as perhaps happens when, you know, a virus is discovered, you can very quickly develop diagnostic tools, find mechanisms, develop a rational approach to the treatment of this defect. And in fact, in 2012, ECOG, Eastern Cooperative Oncology Group, is starting a clinical trial that's anticipated to start enrollment in the fourth quarter with YM155. And let me go over, finally, another type of timeline, is the development of tumor from this asymptomatic infection that is present in the large majority of individuals, is that, as Pat mentioned, this immune suppression is very important. This is a host factor. And MCC is more common in immunosuppressed individuals. Perhaps there is viral reactivation. With this burst of virus, there may be genome integration. The genome can't be maintained unless there is also a second mutation, which is a mutation in the T antigen, thus explaining the rarity of these tumors, even with a common infection. And then the expansion and growth into a very aggressive tumor based on the expression of T antigens in this virus that inhibit the RB pathway and inhibit 4-EBP. And so the lessons learned from MCC that illustrate common themes in tumor virology. Viral tumors are under immune control. Tumorigenesis is a biologic accident incompatible with virus replication, and that tumor virus discovery can rapidly accelerate treatment options. And this final slide is hopefully to entice some of you who are budding tumor virologists or who are virus hunters or gene hunters. Less than 10 years ago, there were only two polyomaviruses, or human polyomaviruses, described, and they were described in 1973, JC virus and BK virus. In 2007, based on advances in technology and sequencing, two new human polyomaviruses were isolated from respiratory secretions. They're KI virus and WU virus, and they're also quite common infections in the human population. They have not been, at this point, associated with any human disease. We found Merkel cell polyomavirus in 2008, and subsequently, rapidly, four other human polyomaviruses have been described. And so these are very intriguing viruses that not a lot is known about. And so hopefully that has piqued your interest. And finally, I'd like to thank the people that worked on the work that we presented. This is the large tumor virus group that we had the honor to work with years ago. This is our present lab at this point, working on the small DNA virus. And I'd like to recognize our collaborators as well as our funding agencies. Thank you very much.